It's so easy to join a campaign and support, but what about being the campaign? You know, what about, oh, wow, that sounds really political. Maybe Cuppy for president.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Presenting. My name is Kane. This is Emily. And today we're so excited to be joined by multi-talented DJ, businesswoman and philanthropist, Cuppy.
Thank you for having me. I am so excited to be chatting with you guys. Cannot wait.
Cuppy, this is Tell Me When. We're going to ask you a few questions and we want you to share the first memories that come to mind.
Okay, I'm ready.
The first time you felt grown up.
When I paid my phone bill.
I think that's actually a huge step.
That's a huge step. Now I'm like, we can't talk for long. Call me off. That was my first professional contract. And we all know we can't live without our phones. So that's the one thing that we're actually going to not play with. Because when that line gets cut off, it's a big deal.
Your first heartbreak.
My first heartbreak was when I was 18 years old, my first year of university. And I have not been heartbroken since then. It showed me a pretty brutal lesson. And what can I say? I break the hearts these days, guys.
Damn. Okay, Cuppy. I'm sorry. So what was that lesson?
That lesson was never, ever to depend on someone else to make you happy. You are responsible for your own happiness. And happiness cannot be determined on your environment, on your popularity, on your success. It can only come from within.
This is a hard one, but the happiest you've ever been.
So my happiest moments, unfortunately, aren't recently, you know, if I'm being honest. And it's not because of what's going on around the world. It's just because being an adult kind of sucks. I love that you asked me the first time I felt like an adult and responsible. Being an adult comes with paying bills. It comes with making decisions. It comes with commitment. It comes with a lot of things that are not so fun. So my happiest memories have to be being a child, listening to Fela Kuti, running around in the field, getting dirty, not caring, just that innocence of being a child.
Cuppy, this is Real Talk, where we go deeper on the issues that really matter. Thank you so much for coming on today to talk about SARS and what is happening in Nigeria. You're doing such important work by raising awareness on all of your social media platforms and your radio show for what is happening in Nigeria. But for those who don't know what's going on, can you just explain what SARS is and why people are protesting?
So SARS is a current complicated issue in Nigeria. It is basically essentially a police force that is against its anti-robbery. It's become basically, unfortunately, the people. SARS has been using their force beyond what's reasonable and been targeting young people. And we've had a string of horrific complications where lives have been lost and there's been conflict between the people and also the officials. And it's quite a generational thing because the young people who are tomorrow's leaders have been the ones that have been able to stand up and protest and say that actually we're not happy with how things are. And you have to understand this happens around the world, but in a country such as Nigeria, where, you know, you're told you're young, you don't have an opinion, you're not experienced enough, you can't run for parliament. It's a big, big, big movement. It's a big deal that this is happening. And I think it's phenomenal what young people are doing. And I'm really proud that I was able to take part in the peaceful protests. And honestly speaking, this is beyond just the surface. It's a deep-rooted problem with Nigeria, where a lot of our leaders are refusing to understand and listen. And it's amazing what the international community are doing to support. Yeah. I feel responsible as a Nigerian myself to raise awareness and also do what I can to make sure that people know what's going on. And obviously, we have to do things, but we have to do them the right way. So it's very important to also find a way of collaborating and looking at the future as well. Because after all, the young people are tomorrow's leaders.
Just how difficult is it for people when they can't even trust the police that are supposed to protect them?
It's certainly very difficult. And a lot of people have spoken to me about it. And they have actually accused me of not understanding it because of my influence and my positioning. I've never been stopped by SARS before, but my team has, my friends have. And it's really important that people understand that just because I haven't had it directly happen to me doesn't mean that I can't understand. So for me, I think it's a problem that affects everybody. And injustice anywhere is a risk to justice everywhere. So it's a problem and it's something that needs to be solved.
So do you often fear for your team and your friend's safety?
I think in Nigeria, a country that has changed over the years, everyone is scared. I don't think anybody in Nigeria is 100% comfortable. Now, the threat is not necessarily all the same kinds of threat, but there's a certain ambiance in Nigeria. You know, a lot of people say, wow, why do Nigerians work so hard? Why are they so on their toes? They're so... It's the fact that our community and our environment forces you to strive under pressure. Just the simplest things are complex. And I think that there's like a beautiful chaos to it. I wouldn't choose to be from anywhere else. I mean, I'm proudly, in case you guys didn't know, I'm from Nigeria.
So do you believe that the government really want to change things even though they're still prosecuting protesters?
It's such a complex situation. You know, a lot of the times as Nigerians, I think apart from not knowing what the government want to do, we don't even know what we want. Our story, we're such a young country and, you know, from colonialism from the UK, you know, to just literally finding our own independence and finding our own feet, to the way we've dealt with our natural resources. It's just such an ever-going debate. What I do know is that the young generation definitely needs to be given more power. And I like to think that the fact that the uprising of End SARS has been able to become a global phenomenon. We've always had a long, long, long history of just condemning our younger generation and not investing in them and telling them to keep quiet. It's almost like, okay, well, you know, until you're 40, you don't have a say. And our population is rising and we're seeing changes with technology and globalization. The world is not what it was. So I, rather than pointing fingers and criticizing the government, I would just tell them to wake up and catch up a bit.
And with the fight far from being over, what can people do to help worldwide?
I think when it comes to helping Nigeria, a lot of people have done a lot of phenomenal things, you know, down from just raising awareness, because End SARS became a global thing because people were sharing their stories and were listening to people. So social media has been a big part of that. But I think more than anything, it's understanding and appreciating those around us. So I don't think that you necessarily have to stop what you're doing and go to Nigeria. I think it's about understanding that, you know, we are a globalized world. So maybe try and understand that person in class that's from another country. Maybe it's about making yourself more aware of what's going on around the world in current affairs. Maybe it's about getting up and going to vote in your own constitution. Sometimes it's little drops that make puddles. It's so easy to join a campaign and support, but what about being the campaign? You know, what about, oh, wow, that sounds really political. Cuppy for president. I think it's about being that change I want to see, and just maybe I need to stop waiting. And maybe as young people, we need to stop waiting.
And you speaking about young people makes me think of the Black Lives Matter movement. How pivotal was this in bringing young people together and making them believe they have the power to make change?
I think the Black Lives Matter movement was beautiful. I'm really glad I got to protest in London. And for me, it was very difficult because, of course, growing up in Nigeria, I didn't really experience racism because, you know, my teacher was Black, the doctor is Black, the lawyer is Black. And so moving to the UK and especially moving to the US was where I really started to feel the disparity and I started to experience racism. And so for me, this movement was so important, not only for young people, for everybody, and going out there and seeing the diverse crowd of people in support was phenomenal. And Black Lives Do Matter, and you know, so many other ethnic minorities experience very similar prejudice against them. And I think it was just like one of those unbelievable moments where you just saw the world come to a halt. I just think we mustn't forget about that.
Interesting that you said that race isn't really a focal point in Africa. Having moved and experienced it in the UK and in America. How does that actually make you feel from someone that has never experienced microaggressions before?
Yeah, I mean, it was quite shocking. Like I said, like, you know, I was used to seeing Black people striving in every corner because of my community. So a lot of us Africans, and I want to say this because I noticed it was a conversation within my group, a lot of Africans just don't necessarily understand why Black Lives Matter was so important, because they don't have those experiences. I think back home in Nigeria, the focal point, and in terms of our protesting and uprising, it's been SARS more than Black Lives Matter. But for me, from the minute I moved here, you know, from 13 in boarding school, I always realized it was pointed out that I looked different, I sounded different, my background was different, my culture was different. And, you know, no amount of money, no amount of positioning can ever change that. And still in my industry, I feel different and I still have to kick down doors. If anything, I also understand that it's worth the fight because I'm opening doors for those to come after me as well.
Cuppy, that was so inspiring to talk to you, and hopefully anyone watching, we have educated more people about this issue. And thank you so much for coming on today to chat with us.
Thank you. Okay, let's go. Manchester United is a great football club with a lot of potential. I would love to see more strikers. I think they need to play Van de Beek more and also consider putting Martial and Pogba and Rashford in a formation. My favorite player is right now Bruno Fernandes, but my ultimate player is Jude Gallo because he's from Nigeria. Megan Thee Stallion is an amazing artist. I love her dominance. I love the fact that she's young. Most importantly, I love the fact that she's in education. She reminds me of myself when I was DJing and also writing essays behind stage. Meg Thee Stallion actually came to Nigeria and I was the only one who got to ride the boat with her, which was really exciting. It's a thing, you know? I was like, now that Megan Thee Stallion has given me a shot, I can die. Burna Boy is a phenomenal artist. He's someone I have a lot of respect for. I actually, surprisingly, I'm not that close to Burna Boy, considering I'm close to a lot of Nigerian artists, but I am very close to his sister, Nisi. And I haven't told anyone this, but Nisi and I are working on a project together. We're on the same label, Platoon. And Burna Boy is actually, I think I was the only Nigerian to interview him right before he won the BET Award last year. And also, Burna Boy, I think, is amazing when it comes to his opinions. And I really, really value him. And kind of cool, in one of his songs in his Grammy-nominated album, he talks about my family. Okay, brilliant. It would have to be Yellow Fever by Fela Kuti. That song was my favorite out of my dad's Fela Kuti collection, and he had it on vinyl. And I love those days because you couldn't really skip through tracks. You just had to go with the flow. And that was always my favorite. And I'm pretty sure I could sing it before I could even speak. So it definitely takes me back. Well, considering it's my job to make people dance, this is a bit of a tough one. I always say as a DJ, it's difficult because we're not meant to play music we want to hear. We're there to please a crowd. So if I was going to dance, this is so cheesy, but it would be probably Push It by Salt and Pepper. I'm actually really good friends with them, and seeing them perform it live just took it to the whole new level. This is another plot twist. It would be Angels by Robbie Williams. When I was 15, we had our school dance and I had my first dance to it, and me and the guy were like 2 meters apart doing this to Angels by Robbie Williams. So I tend to skip it when it comes on. This sounds really cheesy, and no, actually it's not cheesy, it's the truth. I would have my song, Jollof on the Jet, because that is a representation of my life. I'm always on the move. I'm, you know, flying around the world, making global moves, but always taking a piece of home with me. So best believe I'm going to pull up and DJ in Ibiza with my Jollof rice.
And that brings us to the end of today's episode. Cuppy, it's been so lovely to meet you. Thank you for joining the conversation with us here at Presenting. To everyone watching, we hope you enjoyed this as much as we did.
And if you'd like to see more of Cuppy, her socials will be linked in the description below. And for more episodes like this, be sure to like, subscribe, and hit the post notification bell so you never miss an episode. Thank you.
Find out about SARS. Is that something that you've known?
I came home one day and my mum was literally just like bawling her eyes out on the phone. Like she was literally like screaming on the phone, like why are they doing this? Like why are they killing people? Because I went to Nigeria probably end of December 2015. So I was staying on the island. So it's like there's a place called like Lekki. Mm-hmm. So the whole toll gate situation where they were shooting protesters, and it's such a like Lekki's such a beautiful place, and just to see a place like that just be like covered in blood, just so much just gore. And, you know, it kind of leads on to the point of just, in general, how, like, the world is kind of almost numb to, like, black torture, like, black death, black... You know what I mean? Those are the things that you see all the time, and it's kind of...
Like, why do we see it all the time, though? It shouldn't be...
Yeah, and just completely desensitized. Mm-hmm.
It's just, like, people call it, like, trauma porn, like, people just obsessing over these kind of...
Oh, my God.
And it's just weird because, as a person, not from that community, or... Of course, if you've seen like, you know, so many bad things, horrific things happen to black people and you're not from that community, you'll become so, even like people talking now about like allyship fatigue and just so many different things, it's just a shame that even though we're spreading awareness, it kind of goes back and we're still the butt of the joke because people are then becoming numb to our pain, our suffering in a way, which is, honestly, it sucks, man.